He's been struck by an approximately one-ton trailer.
The fast scan's grossly abnormal.
There are major organs in the chest that could have been crushed. Blood pressure, that's pretty shitty. There's no blood going to his kidney. Yeah. The blood vessel has been severed. Where's our blood?
Do it.
We're going to put a recline in on that side. Good luck. Worst case scenario is that Nathan could die.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me? Would you rescue me? But I start to wonder if I'm slipping under. Oh, would you rescue me? Would you
give? We've got a stabbing to the chest.
Oh. The bone's being smashed to bits.
Whoa!
He's actually stopped breathing.
We're going to look after you.
With 80,000 patients a year arriving at the emergency department, it's busy day and night. Emergency doctor Michelle Thornhill is gearing up for a long night on her feet.
You know, one of those things that jiggle your feet? You know, you put your feet on the thing and it jiggles your feet around. I guess it helps with your circulation.
As usual, it's been a really long, really busy shift.
It'll look really funny if we stand here jiggling.
Bands that, wobble shift that away?
Yes. How does that work? Why would that... I don't understand the physiology of shaking.
But I'll give it a go.
Yeah.
The mood changes rapidly with Dr. Michelle's next patient, a young woman who's semi-conscious.
In comes this really serious case.
Hold on.
This does not look good. She needs urgent attention. We drop everything to see what's wrong.
We're just at the hospital. We're going to get you onto the hospital bed.
Just as worried when she sees her is senior emergency doctor Emma West.
What do you think it is?
Oh, don't know. I see an extremely unwell young woman. She's sweaty. She's unconscious.
We actually need to stabilise that airway.
Yeah.
Open your eyes for me.
This is really, really a severe case of someone being super unwell that needs all our emergency care immediately.
This is Brianna. She's 29 years old. She is 17 weeks pregnant. She has woken from sleep with a severe headache. Yes. We found her with a left side hemiplegia and vomiting and severe confusion.
The hemiplegia means the young woman is partly paralysed. It's not only her health, but the health of her unborn baby that's at stake.
It's a lot more concerning when a young woman is pregnant. We actually have to think about two patients rather than one. But when something is this critical, we often just have to focus on the mother, because that's the best chance that the baby has.
She initially was sitting with a heart rate of 60. En route, that dropped to 40 and then 36 just before arrival.
She's got equal pulses. She's not hypertensive. And she's bratty. Get her on cardiac monitoring.
Brianna is sweaty. She's got a low heart rate. So we need to move very, very quickly to find out what's wrong and get the treatment she needs.
I'm just letting you know the call is coming through.
Emergency doctor Luke De La Rue is managing the flow of patients tonight.
He's a 39-year-old who had a one-ton trailer roll over his chest.
Oh, Jesus.
Bjorn speaking.
Hey, Bjorn, it's Luke.
Hey.
Hey, are you able to take a trauma call?
Yes.
Emergency doctor Bjorn Macon will lead the team.
So he's a 39-year-old who had a one-ton trailer roll over their chest.
Ooh. So quite a significant concern about the damage that would have been done to his chest, but also, I suppose, potentially the other injuries sustained to his spine, abdominal organs, pelvis, brain.
He's dropped his blood pressure, systolic of 65, so pretty low. The hems, microcrew are starting blood, so we'll get everything ready. He shouldn't be too far away.
Thanks, bud.
He's pretty sick, but hopefully they'll be able to get him here.
The air ambulance coming in from rural Victoria has been battling strong headwinds all the way, with every delayed second of the trip jeopardising the man's chances of survival.
Can you make sure that this is prepared and ready for the fire scan?
You got someone to do it?
Yes, Dutchie's going to come and do it.
The ED's on the highest level of alert, with a crack team on standby, including senior emergency doctor Martin Dutch.
We're going to do a primary survey, make sure the binder's on, give him some blood, make a decision as to whether or not he's well enough to go to the CT scanner.
Emergency medicine is a team sport. You need lots of different people from specialties to descend at once and each manage individual problems that are going on.
OK.
Hi, everyone.
Hello.
This is Nate.
On slide. Ready, steady, slide.
Hey, mate, I'm good now. One of the emergency nurses, I'll be here at the head of your bed.
He's been struck by an approximately one-ton trailer, come down quite a steep decline. It looks like it's come across his chest, abdo, and his BP dropped quite significantly, the lowest being 64 systolic.
The father of four's low blood pressure is a sign of internal bleeding, but he could have any number of injuries in his chest and abdomen.
Their chest has their lungs and their heart that can be damaged when a trailer runs over it. And in their abdomen, major organs can be torn and cause internal bleeding.
OK, team, what have we got?
The fast scan's grossly abnormal in multiple components. Yeah. Obviously, the left lung's down.
Yeah.
It's certainly positive for fluid, and yeah, that fluid extends down into the pelvis as well.
We know that Nathan's got blood and air in his chest, and I know that if I don't decompress that part of his chest, that it will compress his lungs, it'll compress his heart, oxygen levels are going to drop and blood pressure's going to drop, and it'll eventually result in his death.
Brianna, Brianna, open your eyes for me. She's got a dilated right pupil and a small left pupil.
All right. Her pupil is enlarging, suggesting that there's extreme pressure on the brain.
Brianna, can you open your eyes, doll? No.
The young mum-to-be is displaying symptoms of a stroke, but they're not sure.
Can you say anything to me, Brianna? She's making incomprehensible sounds.
A 29-year-old with possible stroke symptoms, left arm not working and a left facial droop, that's just out of the ordinary, so I'm quite worried.
Brianna? Can you squeeze my hand? Yeah. It's OK, darling, we're here for you, OK?
As she squeezes my hand when I ask her to, it's a way of her letting me know that she's in there, she's alive. She can't speak, but she can squeeze my hand. She's probably terrified. So I'm trying to reassure her that we're there to look after her and her baby.
They need to get Brianna to CT to figure out what's going on.
So the CT table is empty and ready,
yeah,
if we want to go now.
Can we whip her around? I'm going to call neurosurge.
Okay. If we need to, we sprint back.
Yeah.
I want her CT scan so that I can get the neurosurgeons to do an operation should they need to. Every second counts.
All right. Are we almost ready?
Yeah.
The situation looks really bad. If she gets any worse in front of me, it can become literally life or death for her and her baby.
She's about to go to scanner.
Where's the fluid that we were connecting?
It's underneath.
Oh, okay.
And I've got a hand pump line as well.
Okay.
In the Royal Melbourne Emergency Department, 17-week pregnant Brianna is semi-conscious, and Dr. Michelle and Dr. Emma are trying to work out why.
She's having a stroke-like event. We're actually worried about pressure on her brain, and she's very unstable.
Being semi-conscious, she could stop breathing, but they need to see what's going on with her brain.
We believe we have a few minutes up our sleeve to just get her in the CT as quickly as possible and then determine our management from there.
Brianna, squeeze my hand for me, good girl. Brianna, we're just going to do a CT scan.
I'm hoping to see something that explains why Brianna is this unwell. I'm looking for any large bleeds on the brain.
Michelle, I'll go and chat with her family and just let them know that the neurosurgeon's coming and that we're going to try and get them in.
I imagine Brianna's family is terrified. She's been vomiting, she's had a severe headache, and she's stopped moving one side of her body. I can't imagine being in their situation, and I'm sure they just want to know, is she alive? Is she okay?
Waiting in the family room is Brianna's fiance, Jonathan.
I'm an emergency physician and my name's Emma. Brianna, she's very unwell.
Oh.
As I'm speaking to Brianna's partner, I can see him processing what is terrible news. I can't imagine what he must be going through. It's very distressing to hear. I'm so sorry this is happening. Okay, she's in good hands.
Back in CT, Dr. Michelle is hoping the mum-to-be doesn't have a life-threatening brain bleed.
We've just done the first pass of the brain.
I'm looking to see if there's no bleed, to see if she's actually had a clot, maybe, that's blocking the function of her brain.
Dr. Emma rushes back for the results, but Brianna's scans are worse than the doctors thought.
It's massive, right-sided.
It's pretty clear things are really bad. I can see a lot of blood on one side of her brain. It's really shocking to see someone so young with such a catastrophic bleed on the brain.
It could be a stroke or an aneurysm, or possibly something else causing the bleed, which a neurosurgeon will work out. But it's a relief that Brianna and her unborn child have made it this far. The 29-year-old still has the fight of her life ahead of her.
It does give you that awful heart sink feeling. This is a huge challenge for Brianna in terms of her surviving what is an awful, awful, severe bleed.
All right, let's go.
Pressure is high in the ED tonight. Down the corridor, there's another full-on emergency underway.
What access have we got at the moment? We've got, like...
16 on this side.
Just one 16? Yeah.
Dr. Bjorn's patient is hanging on to life after being crushed by a one-ton camper trailer.
We're going to put a recline in on that side, which will give us decent access to resuscitate.
So far, they've discovered a build-up of air and blood in Nathan's chest. If it's not drained, the father of four's life could be in jeopardy.
Blood or air in your chest pushes on the lungs and the heart. It prevents the heart from being able to pump, prevents your lungs from being able to expand, which affects your ability to breathe and get oxygen in.
The team is cutting an access hole directly into Nathan's chest.
OK, so we've secured the chest drain in and that's all working fine. How's the pain at the moment?
Nathan, how's the pain? Is it better after the ketamine and fentanyl that we gave you?
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Nathan was unhitching his camper trailer at the start of a family vacation when it rolled on him. His wife, Carla, saw him crushed by the one-ton weight.
I've never heard him scream the way that he did and how quickly the whole thing escalated as well, from needing an ambulance to then requiring being airlifted to Melbourne.
How's your breathing feeling, mate?
All right.
All right at the moment, OK.
Radiology's here, doing a chest X-ray and then a pelvis.
What's your X-ray when everyone's ready.
OK, anyone who's not wearing lead, get up, please.
It's a relief Nathan's chest is draining and his damaged lung inflating. But Dr. Martin wants to know what else could be wrong.
I'm still worried about what might be going on in the abdomen.
So maybe it's all just subdiaphragmatic, the fluid and muck that I was seeing, but sort of unusual position of small bowel.
I suppose CT will tell us.
But they can't take Nathan to CT with his dangerously low blood pressure.
OK, blood pressure, that's pretty shitty.
Nathan needs blood fast to get his blood pressure up, and the way to do that is wide-bore intravenous access, or RICline, which Dr. Martin is doing.
Where's blood? Yeah, where's our... There we go. You see, the minute you... Yeah. Can we get that FFP in? And we'll use the RICline, please.
All right, blood pressure cycling.
Blood pressure's up, which is good, so... Thomas, if you can just have everything absolutely ready to rock and roll, that'd be great. If his BP drops below 90, then let's give the red cells next. But at the moment, that is a fantastic BP. Now, Matt, do you feel comfortable taking him through the scanner?
Yep. Yeah.
We've performed the necessary interventions in order to deal with the bleeding that we've seen in his chest. We don't know what bleeding's going on in his abdomen, and we don't know what spinal injuries or other bony injuries he might potentially have. So we're going to use a CT scan in order to be able to diagnose that.
Probably going to have some decent injuries, I reckon.
I'm really worried about Nathan. If he's got significant intra-abdominal bleeding, this could result in a threat to his life.
1, 2, 3.
The Royal Melbourne Emergency Department gets another call. This time, a critically injured motorbike rider is on the way. Emergency doctor Michael Dunn is ready.
With any motorcycle accidents, I'm concerned that there's serious injuries going on. The speed they come off and their protection is so minimal. Their risk of having spinal injuries, brain bleeds, or intra-abdominal injuries is very, very high.
Hello, team. Yeah.
Motorbike.
Is this Joseph?
Yeah, Joseph.
You come off your bike today, didn't you?
Did I?
The 48-year-old seems oblivious to what he's been through.
Joseph, we'll get you across, have a good look at you. You stay perfectly still. 1, 2, 3.
It's all done, Joe. So Joe's involved in a motorbike accident today. Sounds like he's trying to overtake another motorbike, but they were actually pulling off the road. And then they sort of both hit. And then he's come down an embankment as well, but he doesn't have any recollection of that. We've been with him for a good 2.5 hours now. He's still sort of pretty confused. His main complaint has been with us, pain in the back right-hand side, sort of around the scapula.
After hearing about his amnesia, my concern is that he has a brain injury or a spinal injury. And that's the first things I check for very quickly to know what is going on.
Hey, will you open your eyes for me? Open your eyes once more. Good man. Good. Can you wiggle your hands for me? Wiggle your toes? Good. Any numbness anywhere? No. Do you know what happened today?
It looks like I had a little accident.
Yeah, come on. Do you know what month it is?
No.
Joseph can't tell me what month it is, can't tell me what happened. So a concussion is the best case scenario, but then obviously the worst case scenario is he has some bleeding around the brain.
Take a nice big breath for me. And out. Pain here?
Yeah.
A little bit, yeah. Any pain in the tummy at all?
No.
If he has a significant injury and he deteriorates unexpectedly, if we haven't picked up what the injury is and things go south, it could be potentially life-threatening.
She's been hypotensive at all.
High, poor, not lower than like 95.
No.
Coming back from CT, Dr. Michelle and Dr. Emma are trying to save the life of 17-week pregnant Brianna.
A young person right in the prime of their life, about to bring life into the world. We know that the stakes are higher. We know that there's two people to care for here.
They've discovered the 29-year-old has a massive brain bleed. Dr. Emma continues to check for responses.
Brianna, can you squeeze my hand? Good girl.
Emma, you want to do the tube?
I'm happy to.
To keep her stable, Dr. Michelle and Dr. Emma decide the best thing for Brianna is to be put on life support.
We need to make sure she gets enough oxygen, enough blood pressure, so that she can get safely to the operating theatre.
I'm giving drugs. This should be saline.
To intubate Brianna, there are several rules and we all need to be really prepared and aware of what's happening.
Just gonna put you off to sleep.
1, 3, 1, 2, 3. Perfect, that's good. She's very stiff and moving over to the right. She's adopting some abnormal posturing and that's just suggesting things are getting worse and worse in terms of pressure on the brain. Things are really, really dire right now, and we just need to do everything we can to give her any chance of survival.
I can't see the time, but you tell me when I've given 2 minutes of pre-oxygenation.
Sure. We first apply oxygen before we paralyse her.
She's fighting me.
Yeah, fighting me as well. Yeah. We start with some fentanyl. Yes.
We then give medications to sedate and paralyse Brianna to stop her breathing momentarily.
Are you ready for me to give anaesthetic?
Yeah.
Let me just see this blood pressure come up that's reading. All right, 123.81. So that's 80.
I reckon that's about 45, yeah.
I use a laryngoscope to look inside Brianna's mouth and down to her vocal cords with an endotracheal tube that goes through those cords and into her lungs to provide oxygen.
Grade one view.
The room is extremely tense at the moment. If you don't get the tube in, their brain and organs are starved of oxygen and nutrients.
Stats of 100. Just need end tidal. But end tidal.
Intubating Brianna has gone seamlessly. I just feel so relieved that things are controlled and safe.
That was good. Smooth tube.
But it's the next steps that are the really big part of Brianna's future, getting her to the operating theatre and letting the neurosurgeons do their work.
With neurosurgeons on the way, Dr. Emma and Dr. Michelle stay close, monitoring Brianna.
Blood pressure still holding.
What you need to do is bring your hands towards your chest.
Over in CT, father of four Nathan is being scanned for life-threatening injuries after his one-ton trailer rolled onto him.
All right, so we're going to give you that injection halfway through.
The CT scan will absolutely define what is the extent of his injuries and potentially find injuries that we weren't aware of.
The business analyst was on holiday with his family when he was run over by his camper trailer. Dr. Bjorn and Dr. Martin are about to find out what the one-ton weight has done to Nathan's internal organs.
What's wrong with this picture?
Well, there's no blood going to his kidney. Yeah.
Pretty dramatic scan.
That is, isn't it?
It's transected right there.
Here's a nice, healthy kidney. Here's his other kidney on this side, and it's dark because the blood vessel that's supplied it has been torn off, so that kidney is no longer for this world.
It's lucky that we're designed with two kidneys because, you know, we can absolutely survive with one kidney. It's not necessarily an injury that's life-threatening.
Dr. Bjorn is a little astounded. Nathan doesn't have more injuries around his chest where the trailer pinned him.
Spleen is OK?
Spleen is perfectly fine, yeah.
Wow. And the chest?
Surprisingly, nothing.
Rib fractures, though, surely.
Couldn't even see any, to be honest. Maybe
really?
A couple, but yeah.
Although we were initially really worried about his chest wall and his ribs, the force has gone more through his upper abdomen than it has through his chest.
And there's nothing in the liver?
His liver's got a big grade 5 laceration.
Ooh, yeah. Nathan's chance of survival is extremely good. Yes, he's got the blunt injuries to his kidney and to his liver, but that's under control. So what do you guys want to do?
I think he's just going to go up to ICU and we'll keep an eye on him.
So they're going to take him?
Yeah.
Okay.
While Nathan is being admitted to intensive care, he won't be needing a major operation.
If you think about the initial story of this man being run over by a one-ton trailer, yes, he's got a kidney injury and he's lost a kidney, but I think this is a better outcome than I would have predicted. And I hope the story ends with him walking out of the hospital and giving his wife and young kids a hug or something.
It's a long night in the emergency department, and no one's feeling it more than emergency doctor Jana Alexander.
I need to drink some water.
To stop any potential spread of COVID, staff can only take off their masks for a drink of water in a designated room.
Being pregnant, I have to keep drinking. I get really thirsty really quickly, so I drink a lot.
For Dr. Jenna, who's due to give birth in just a few weeks, Keeping hydrated is especially challenging.
You have to pee all the time. And then I have to walk upstairs or go to the loo, like, every hour, it feels like.
I've got two little girls. One's 5 and one's 2.5. I worked all the way through those pregnancies as well. It's difficult being a mum and working shift work and being pregnant and trying to juggle all of those balls.
That's the biggest I will look. That's why I'm wearing black, slimming.
But my colleagues are really good at looking out for me and making sure I'm taking it easy. They're always trying to send me home early.
A few precious minutes to catch her breath and Dr. Jana is on the go again.
Hey, Katrina.
Her next patient is 52-year-old Katrina.
Watch your elbow there, Katrina. Sorry, darling, I know that's uncomfortable.
Katrina is in shock and very distressed with terrible facial grazes after being knocked off her electric bike by a car and then flung over the handlebars.
Can you straighten that arm out a little bit?
Both her wrists are painfully swollen and deformed.
Is that better?
Sorry, I'm just going to shake.
No, you're fine. You're doing great.
Nervousness.
Dr. Jana suspects she's broken both wrists.
That's okay. You're all right.
If she's broken both her wrists, that's devastating for her. Having one wrist even broken means a cast for 6 to 8 weeks.
I'm just not really up to it today.
I know.
It's especially devastating for Katrina because she has a special needs son to take care of.
Having somebody to care for, even one of her wrists being fractured, would be significant. Let's get the x-ray up. So she fell onto her wrists. What would you say about that x-ray?
There's a fracture at the radius.
It's not good news for Katrina. It looks like she's broken both her wrists, which is what we were worried about.
So it looks shortened and it's displaced vertebrae.
Both your wrists being fractured means being in two casts. And that means that she'll really struggle to complete even the simplest of tasks, like cooking or looking after her son with special needs. That's devastating for her.
You've come off your motorbike.
Have I really?
Yeah.
Across the corridor, 48-year-old Joseph has been badly injured in a motorbike accident he can't recall.
Can't remember exactly what happened, but, you know, I just obviously come off the bike.
Joseph's wife, Lisa, is home looking after the couple's 3 kids. She's desperate to hear how he is.
How did you come off the bike?
I can't remember. I'm feeling OK.
But you've got concussion?
No, I think I'm coming to now.
Well, you've got concussion, but were you on your own or was Anthony with you? I can't remember, but I'm okay, all right?
The loss of memory is worrying Dr. Michael, but there's other injuries he needs to assess.
Joseph does have amnesia, but there's always the risk of internal injuries to the chest or to the abdomen. Given the speed that he came off.
Just
going to
do an x-ray.
Thank you.
X-ray.
There's the line there.
The deformed rib cage on
that side. Right there, yeah.
That's a dent, and then here's some fractures as well, aren't there?
On the x-ray, what we're seeing is some definite broken ribs, and there's probably more than what we can see on the x-ray.
Joseph, you've broken a couple of ribs on that side. How are you feeling? Do you have any pain?
No.
You sure?
Do you need any more painkiller?
I'm not understand.
You're all right? Okay.
He's a tough bloke, isn't he?
Any pain? No.
I'm quite surprised Joseph was refusing painkillers because broken ribs are incredibly painful. And the important thing is if he doesn't breathe in deeply, he'll get a secondary, chest infection from that.
The x-ray also shows Joseph has a badly damaged lung. Air is leaking into his chest wall, affecting his breathing. The only way to relieve it is to drain it.
Joseph, your oxygen level's getting worse.
Now our decision is, do we put a chest tube in to relieve that? Or can it wait and we get a CT scan to have a full idea of the extent of his injuries?
Do we do it now, not knowing if he's bleeding somewhere, or do we wait until the scans before we go ahead and do it?
Dr. Michael is weighing up chest tube versus CT scan, which in Joseph's case is just as urgent.
The worry is, are we missing a bleed in the brain, spending too long putting this tube in and that bleed's getting bigger?
Would you rather not? If you prefer he goes to CT, we can go to CT first.
On the other hand, if we hold off on the chest tube and go to CT, if that pneumothorax gets bigger, his oxygen levels could get dangerously low and potentially people can have cardiac arrest.
I think we need to get a slightly better drip in.
In Resource Base 6, 52-year-old Katrina has just been given the devastating news she's broken both her wrists after a car knocked her off her electric bike.
Nasty old scratch coming now. I'm so sorry. I know that's sore.
We're going to have to give her a sedation to help us perform this procedure safely.
Dr. Jenna and the team are going to pull on her broken bones to realign them before she goes for an operation.
So we're going to get some oxygen on you first.
We have to be mindful because her oxygen levels aren't great. I need to be really careful that she doesn't stop breathing altogether.
Having two broken wrists is also going to impact her livelihood as an artist.
50 of fentanyl. This is the pain relief. This is the stuff that's going to make you sleepy, sleepy. Stings a little bit going up the arm, and then you'll be fast asleep, OK? Nice, slow breaths. OK, quick.
The sedative is short-acting, so the team needs to work quickly.
You're OK, my love. Just going to give her a tiny bit more.
Now the sedation seems to be working. Ben's providing some downward traction on that wrist while Abby provides counter traction. And they're essentially pulling that wrist out to length and disimpacting those broken bones.
Just keep on breathing, Katrina, you're doing really well.
Hopefully we've timed it nicely that she'll just wake up once he's all done. Looks a bit better, Ben. Yeah, do you want to start plastering? Working quickly is important because propofol can lower your blood pressure. It stops you breathing. And you can see Sam's just supporting her airway, so she'll keep breathing. So as the drug wears off and Ben finishes, she should just start to take some nice big breaths.
We're pretty happy with how the wrist looks. We'll have to confirm with an x-ray, but what that means is we can stop giving her sedation and just allow her to wake up slowly.
How are you doing, Katrina?
Next, we'll have to put her in plaster of Paris, so that will keep her wrist immobilized in the position that we've just achieved with the reduction.
Hello, Katrina. The worst bit's done, OK?
She's taking some nice big deep breaths for me, Katrina.
We've done the most displaced wrist. The next stage, Ben doesn't have to do as much of the pushing and pulling. He just has to pop the plaster on, so it should be OK. So hopefully she'll not be as sore when she wakes up.
For Katrina's left wrist, it doesn't need a reduction. It just needs a plaster to keep it immobilized, so she won't need any further sedation.
All done.
Being an artist, it's really unfortunate that she's going to be in bilateral casts for the next few weeks. It's going to significantly impact her ability to do what she loves, and also she's going to need a lot of help towards her recovery.
Katrina's already turning her mind to the challenges ahead.
So I've got a son who's got special needs, so yeah, so it's been right out of whack at the moment, yeah. But that's the breaks, you know, you get on with life and do what you can.
Having both her wrists out of action is going to really impact the simplest things like getting dressed in the morning and cooking for herself. I don't know how I would cope in a similar situation, not being able to use both my arms. I think that would be really hard.
Even though Katrina has a tough road ahead, she's strong.
I might be drawing for a while. Oh, well. I'll get through it. Keep positive and I'll get there. Yeah.
There was no movement on the left side.
No,
nothing at all.
She was drowsy. Was she verbal at all at that time?
She attempted to make a sound, but really, yeah. Like that.
In trauma one, the fight continues to save 17-week pregnant Brianna, who's had a catastrophic brain bleed.
All right, so left side is erected.
The question is what caused the bleed, which is unusual in a 29-year-old. Neurosurgeon Cecilia Hugh now knows from studying her CT scans.
What do you think's going on?
Ruptured AVM.
She's got a ruptured AVM. An AVM is an arteriovenous malformation. It's essentially where there's an abnormal connection between the arteries and the veins. So the high pressure that's in the blood in the arteries communicates abnormally with the veins. There's weakness in the walls, and at any moment, those walls can rupture and cause this kind of bleed.
People are born with AVM, but Brianna being pregnant is a high-risk time for things to go wrong.
Pregnancy, your blood pressure changes, you get increased blood volume, and your heart is pumping harder. And all of those factors increase the risk of rupture of an AVM. The neurosurgeon's taking Brianna immediately to theatre to stop the bleeding vessel and to relieve pressure on Brianna's brain.
But Brianna and her unborn child are still in danger.
The pressure on her brain is severe, and at any moment that can worsen. There's still a chance that she actually may die in theatre while having her operation. But she's in the hands of people who know what they're doing, and she's being given every opportunity to survive.
In the CT at the Royal Melbourne Hospital, motorbike rider Joseph is being scanned for internal injuries after a serious accident.
Is there any problems with the brain? Is there any bleeding going on?
Joseph has memory loss, and Dr. Michael is hoping the scan might rule out serious brain damage.
That looks okay. Brain looks good. Neck looks good.
The fact that he's come off at such a speed and he hasn't had any significant head injury is quite fortunate.
Thankfully, the CT scan shows that his brain and spine looks quite good, but I am still quite concerned about his chest.
That's pretty displaced. That's all posterior though, isn't it?
Unfortunately, the scan of Joseph's lungs is not so good.
So he's got a pneumothorax, which is what we thought. He's also got some bruising to the lung itself. Can't get oxygen into that segment of the lung that well, which is probably why his oxygen levels low as well. Hey, how's your pain?
It's manageable.
Is it though, or are you being brave? How much painkillers has he had so far?
I haven't actually really had anything.
Ah, no. You've multiple broken ribs.
Have I?
Yeah.
Whoa, that's not good.
You've broken a few ribs and you've broken your collarbone. And you also have a bit of a collapsed lung. Now, the main reason your oxygen level is low isn't the collapsed lung, is that part of your lung is badly bruised.
Yes.
So that part isn't working as it should. It's just kind of full of blood and kind of inflamed. The most important thing at this point is your pain is controlled and you're taking big breaths in. Because the last thing we want is you not to fully expand the lung that's there and get a secondary infection.
Okay, yeah.
So let us know when you need painkillers, if it's restricting you from breathing.
Obviously, he does have quite significant chest wall injuries, and there's a good chance Joseph may need a chest tube later on, but at this point, he seems to be stable, so we're gonna avoid doing it at this point in time.
Joseph, you come off your bike today, didn't you?
Did I?
Yeah, is that right? Is that what you remember?
I don't remember.
That's what happened.
Joseph's concussion will probably linger for a few weeks. Oftentimes, you feel like you're in a fog and you can't quite concentrate, and that's quite normal. But with time, that will resolve.
He's been struck by an approximately one-ton trailer.
Father of four Nathan arrived by air ambulance with critical internal injuries after his one-ton camper trailer rolled over him.
Okay, blood pressure, that's pretty shitty.
The team drained his chest and gave him a life-saving blood transfusion.
There's no blood going to his kidney.
Pretty dramatic scan.
That is, isn't it?
Nathan lost a kidney and had a serious liver laceration.
Down you get.
In just 5 weeks, Nathan has made great strides in his recovery.
I'm jumping back. I was pretty scared, pretty worried. My wife and my daughters mean everything to me. A lot of time in hospital was spent thinking about them and how it would affect them.
He's had a procedure on his liver and is still a bit sore, but Nathan's grateful to be home with his family.
I feel extremely lucky to be alive and to be in the position that I am. so many other things could have gone wrong.
Nathan's determined to get back to a normal life.
So this is where we store the Widowmaker. This is the trailer.
He's already planning his next family holiday.
My goal to be back to 100% so I can enjoy the things that I used to with them. Going down to the beach, taking them for a surf, just being the dad that I used to be. Yeah, get a bun.
Okay, my love.
Artist Katrina broke both of her wrists when she was knocked off her electric bike.
Working quickly is important because propofol stops you breathing. Quick.
Dr. Jana oversaw a reduction to pull her wrist back into position. But having both her arms in plaster was a big blow for Katrina. After surgery, Katrina is slowly recovering at home with help.
You come off your bike today, didn't you?
Did I?
48-year-old Joseph was badly injured in a motorbike smash, but couldn't remember the accident.
Do you know what month it is?
No.
Dr. Michael cleared him of a brain injury, but found he had damage to his lung.
It looks like your right lung has collapsed, okay?
After he left the emergency department, Joseph went on to have a chest drain. He's now back home with his wife and kids, and is feeling like his old self again. But he still has no recollection of the crash.
This is Brianna. She's 29 years old. She is 17 weeks pregnant.
Young mum-to-be Brianna arrived at the emergency department seriously ill.
Brianna, open your eyes for me.
She's got a dilated right pupil and a small left pupil.
Her scan results showed a shocking brain bleed.
It's massive, right-sided.
Dr. Emma and Dr. Michelle put her on life support. Neurosurgeons operated to relieve the pressure on her brain. They worried that Brianna and her unborn baby might not survive. 3 months later, and after multiple surgeries, Brianna is in rehab and waiting for the birth of her baby.
Brianna's doing okay. She's considering how heavy her stroke was. Everyone, especially the doctors, were always so surprised at how well she's doing. So we're hoping that once the baby is delivered, she can then focus on intensive rehab for herself so she can get home as soon as possible. We had planned to get married in June. We had to sort of postpone that to, when she can walk herself, hopefully down the aisle with her dad, that would be really nice.